Both the brain and law regulate human behavior. Only recently have all these lit medical tools come available. CTs, MEGs, ERPs, and my favorite, the FMRI, which allows the human brain itself to finally be studied. We now have a dope set of brain imaging techniques, so can we use our fantastic new neural knowledge in the courtroom? Can we? Well, the intersection of neuroscience and law is called Neuro Law. You can deadass put neuro in front of anything and make it cooler. Watch. Neuro country music. Never mind, broke it already. In fact, my brain made me do it is becoming a much more popular defense in the courts, such as blaming earlier head trauma or brain disorders for criminal actions. On one hand, a person in the court using the excuse, "My brain did the crime," is in the wrong. Any neurotypical person should act in a pro-social way, obey the law, and only use the brain to, I don't know, tweet memes. On the other hand, that person in court is in the right. Their brain did make them do something, and if neurological evidence shows that they have abnormal activity in their brain, or previously undiagnosed disorder, those things should be taken into account. And there are different legal terms to define a defendant's culpability or even an individual's capacity to take the stand. These defenses argue competency, criminal responsibility, and diminished capacity of the defendant, causing them to commit the crime in question. However, these are based on psychological evaluations, which are 100% cut and dry in the courtroom, right? Well, you're wrong. For example, memories of events are very important in courtrooms, but memories are not fully reliable. They deteriorate over time, trauma might make us remember events very differently from our points of view, people are really good at remembering the gist of things, but details are a little bit more difficult, and the way questions are asked about those details could make people remember those details falsely. And that's why we use lie detectors, right? No. If you've ever watched any courtroom procedural, you've probably heard that lie detector tests are inadmissible in court. Why? Well, a polygraph measures blood pressure, perspiration, and heart rate, and attempts to correlate them with telling lies. Those metrics aren't 100% correlational, which makes them unreliable. But what's stronger than a lie detector? An fMRI, perhaps? First, yes, fMRIs have been found to be able to differentiate truth versus lies by changes in prefrontal cortex activity, but a guilty suspect who firmly believes that they are not guilty may be able to finesse a false positive in an fMRI study. Furthermore, even if fMRIs find an increase in activity in certain regions of the brain when a subject is lying, this does not mean that that increase in activity means that the participant has to be lying. Again, correlation, not causation. So what is neural law good for? Absolutely nothing. Moment of truth. Rush hour, Edwin Starr. Good God, y'all. Until concrete, infallible techniques can be brought to the stand, neural law is at a standstill. Both medical and legal procedures need to be taken into account to bring neuroscience into the courtroom. Both a bar counsel and a medical board would need to come together to regularly review the techniques and advances in order to bridge the two disciplines. More knowledge about the use of science in law and law in neuroscience would need to be added to curricula so future neuro lawyers can grasp how their disciplines would be used. Neuro lawyer is such a dope title, like if you saw that on Tinder, right swipe. Now, I may be a simple city science boy, but in my humble opinion, neuro law would help us apply medical knowledge and technology to the law as it stands to make a more equitable legal system. Mental health status, racial bias, and damage of decision-making or impulse control areas of the brain could help prove liability and do wonders in the courtroom. Yo, thanks for watching. Make sure you subscribe to Seeker. Speaking of crime and brains, and guess what? Yeah, we got more crime and brains for you. Check out this other episode about how Einstein's brain was stolen, preserved, dissected, and sent across the whole country in pieces. That's crazy. And if you're really in your feelings, good or bad, leave me a comment below. And again, thank you so much for watching.